Record on this computer. All right, Raghav. So, welcome to this debriefing session. Congratulations on scoring a 730. How does that feel?
It feels nice, to be honest, because when I started preparing for the GMAT, I wasn't really sure what it would take me. My expectations when I started it in May this year was to cross 700. I think I got a 730, so I clearly achieved my expectations. So, yeah, it does feel good.
All right. So for you are a lawyer by profession, by education as well, which I think in the law field, that's the only way it works, not in the engineering field. So really good quant score, really good verbal score around that 90th percentile in verbal, similarly around that 90th percentile in quant. So let's talk about your preparation. You said you started preparing sometime towards end of May. And you started with the official guide. Can you just walk us through your preparation?
So somewhere around the end of May is when I bought the official guide and I started solving questions. I was comfortable solving quant because that is what I studied even in my 11th and 12th standard. So I was kind of comfortable with the questions. Verbal was a bit tricky for me, but I was getting some questions right, some questions wrong. So it was going well. I must have taken around 3 to 4 weeks to finish up the official guide. And in the meantime, I took up the first and second official mock test, wherein I scored a 700 and a 710, if I'm not wrong. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I was getting the kind of scores which I had the expectations of getting before I started the preparation. But somewhere I wasn't really confident with my preparation, especially verbal. While I still was confident in terms of my knowledge and preparation for quant, verbal was still for a lot of questions on my gut feeling. Just, you know, say for example, if it's sentence correction, I would read the 5 options and I would be like, okay, this sounds the most correct option. And I would go ahead with that. So sometimes that would turn out to be right. And a lot of the times it won't. That is when I decided, given that I have the time, I should have a more structured approach towards the whole preparation. And that is when I started looking towards various online coaching options, because honestly, that time only online coachings were available. So that's when I started doing that. One of my family friends, in fact, suggested me that I should take eGMAT. Because that time, like, I went on the GMAT club page and there were some 10, 12 coaching institutions, which, I mean, at least on the face of it, were offering more or less the same thing. So I was really confused as to which one should I choose. But this family friend of mine vouched for eGMAT. He told me, you know, if verbal is something that you're worried about, this is the best in the market without any doubt. And I mean, that's when I made my decision. I took up eGMAT. And I think somewhere around the end of June is when I started with my preparation through eGMAT. Okay. I must have finished the curriculum of eGMAT in the next 2 months. So I think by the end of August, I was pretty much done with whatever modules I had to go through. So I pretty much went through the entire curriculum, be it verbal or quant. I finished that up. And then I started taking the questions. And I think when that came, Scholarinium was a big, big help. I think it has over 4,000 questions. So that really gave me a big amount of questions to practice and, you know, just improve my skills. And then there were, you know, different kinds of tests, ability tests, cementing tests, and a whole lot of things, which really helped me improve the places where I was faltering on. And then, the best thing which I really liked about eGMAT is that, you know, it turned out to be a one-stop shop for me, be it the preparation for the module, so be it your lectures, be it the questions, be it the tests, so the Sigma X mock test, all of it really helped me. And I think the biggest problem, at least which I faced initially before I took up eGMAT, was there is a lot of material available online. Like, there is just so much, and you know, one might end up wasting so much time. I mean, if you just look at the GMAT club page, I'm sure you can spend months and months on it without really gaining anything out of it if you don't have a structured approach. So one thing which I really liked about eGMAT is when I started studying from eGMAT, I didn't even have to look anywhere else except for the official tests, which I took up later on. So eGMAT pretty much was my entire preparatory material, and I was very happy and satisfied with it. So yeah, I did that for the next 2 months. And then in September, I solved the original guide again. I took the mocks again, official mocks three to six. And then 18 September, I think, is the date when I took the GMAT online attempt the first time.
Okay, so I think let's kind of go back. Thank you for that summary. It was very, very helpful. And it summarizes, and I think, yeah, you're right, given I think about 95% of all that preparation that you had, barring that first month when you had the official guide, was on the platform. Now, you said when you prepared in the first stage of your preparation, when you were doing it just using the official guide. So as you were answering questions, you weren't as confident. So when you went through the eGMAT course, what changed?
So sorry, I didn't hear you.
So in early on, prior to going through the eGMAT course, you weren't as confident while answering questions. So after going through the eGMAT course, what changed? How did you become more confident on the verbal side of things?
Multiple things, actually. Like, the first thing is knowing the concepts. When I was solving from the official guide, there were questions, and then when I would choose an answer, then there would be an explanation to that question. There wasn't really any conceptual teaching when I was solving the official guide. The first thing is the modules. And one thing which I really liked about eGMAT is not just verbal section was subdivided into the three subsections, but those subsections were divided into modules, and those modules were further divided into submodules. So
there activities. Was we a call lot them of conceptual...
Okay. Yeah. So activities. So there were a lot of activities to understand and learn the concept. So that was the first and the most important thing which made me confident, because then what started happening is when I looked at a question, I knew why an answer is right, why an answer is wrong. The second most important thing was it was not just conceptual. After every 1-2 conceptual sessions would be a practice quiz in the modules itself.
Yes.
So, it's not like you are just mugging up all the concepts and there is no practice. So it is you learn something, you practice it then and there. If you could, the platform would suggest that you could move ahead. If not, you revisit it, you revise the module again. So the second thing was, at the time when you're studying the module, you know if you have understood it correctly or not.
There's a course correction happening.
Correct. At the very moment when you are studying, and not once after you have studied everything and then going back to the questions. Because what happens is there are some, the modules have some, say, 50 different activities. Now, if I study all the activities and then I randomly solve questions, I wouldn't really understand which are the activities which I am confident with and which are the modules or the activities which I am not so confident about. So practicing questions along with every module is something which really helps strengthen your concept in that module.
Nah,
and
very
then
well said.
Third limb of it is, of course, the test. And I mean, the third limb of it is, of course, the test, because even in the test, you can choose what section you want to do, whether you want to do a sentence correction question or you want to do a reading comprehension question. You can choose the difficulty of the questions. So, I started initially with a few easy questions. Then I moved to the medium level questions. So I understood what's the difference between these two questions. Then from medium, I went on to hard questions. So I understood, what is it that is going to take for me to really all these hard questions. So that bifurcation in that sense, I think, was really helpful. And this entire process instantly made me much more confident about my verbal abilities.
Got it. So you also reached out to the eGMAT team. How was that experience and what did you get out of it?
I think my biggest concern before deciding to do an online coaching was how responsive the team is, because when you are in an offline setup, you can ask the question then and there. In an online setup, there is a module, there is a question, there is an explanation. You might not understand the explanation every time. You might want to ask the questions again. So two things which really helped were, one was that question forum, wherein all the questions that have been asked by students before are there. So I think 80% of the times, if somebody just goes through the questions previously posted, your question would inevitably be there and you would find a satisfactory answer. And the second thing, honestly, was just how quick the responses were. I don't think there has been even a single time when the responses have taken more than 24 hours. Every time I have gotten a response in less than 24 hours, and these are detailed responses. So in that sense, I wrote my biggest concern before joining an online coaching wasn't really a concern eventually, because it felt like if I have any doubt today, I post it tomorrow morning, I'll have an answer to it. So that, I think, like, the eGMAT team in that sense is very helpful and very quick, in fact, in responding. Because what happens is, if the response is not quick, you might solve another 50 questions, you might have another 10 doubts. So the process just gets delayed. If your response time is within 24 hours, that really was, in fact, very, very, very helpful for me. And the forum, the question forum.
So, and you also attended the Live Sessions 360. You attended a few sessions by Payal. So how did that help improve your score?
In fact, that turned out to be very helpful, because even after all this preparation, if you were to ask me what is one area where I'm still not the most confident, if I were to choose one weak area, that was sentence correction. I had booked my GMAT for the 18th September, and I realized sometime in the beginning of September, I think the 3rd of September, is when the sentence correction classes started, file sentence correction classes started. So although I took the 2-week free trial for that, and I attended around 8 out of the 10 sessions. And I think that really helped me. That made a difference. Just the way in which, you know, Payal helped me understand things. So, I mean, the major difference was, before those sessions, I was focusing a lot on, you know, the rules and what can be used, what words cannot be used, and the rules in grammatical rules and all of that. Like, one thing, if I had to choose from those 8 sessions, which really helped me, was just, you know, Payal telling each one of us, you know, you understand the meaning of the sentence, understand what the sentence means and go by that. And I think just that one switch really helped me. I think initially I wasn't paying so much attention on the meaning analysis, although that was amply stressed upon even during the lectures. But I would be honest, I don't think I was stressing so much on it before the classes started. And that is one change that I made after those 7-8 sessions. And the results were clear. Like, you won't believe. So when I took the 5th and 6th mock before 5 sessions, and I got 720 in both the attempts. After the sessions, I took mock 3 and mock 4. And I was taking them the first time. I got a 760, 770.
Wow. So you can get a 760.
I would like to believe so, yeah.
Yeah, good. I'm glad that's such a
difference after those classes.
Oh, wow. That's really good to know. That's wonderful. So let's talk about your post-GMAT journey. I think we've talked enough about your GMAT. You're a lawyer by profession. You want to go into finance, private equity, investment banking is what you talked about, or in fact, even corporate finance. And you don't have a preference with regards to schools, whether in, you know, you're open to studying in India, or you're open to going abroad, whether it's in Southeast Asia, such as Singapore, or whether it's Europe or the US. Or in fact, probably even Canada, I hope. So you have 3 questions. First of all, you have 2 years of experience. Are you too young? I think let's talk about that. So years of experience is a measure of the kind of experience you've had. So it depends on what you've done during those 2 years. I mean, there are people who have 4 years of experience, which kind of is the ideal. And they haven't done a whole lot. They continue to do the same things during those 4 years. So in that case, yes, 4 years is a number. But when you think about a business school saying you need 4 years, you have to ask, what's the goal with those 4 years? What is it a substitute for? It's a substitute for the kind of experience you have. It's a substitute for, okay, are you certain about what you want to do? And have you reached that professional and mental maturity? So the answer would truly depend on what have you done in these 2 years and compared to you know, what other people do. So if you find out, hey, you've done enough things in those 2 years that others do in 3 years, and you still have a year before, you know, you actually join, then maybe you are there. On the other hand, if you're just someone who's like an average guy who's done the same things that others have done in 2 years, then maybe wait a year and then do it. So I think that's kind of where my response would be. It just depends on how you are compared to others. Then the second question, this is the third question, but I'm going to put it as a second question right now because it's an easy one to answer. Would 750, 760 make a difference over 730? When it comes to admissions, I would say about a 20% difference. So it will push your case that slightly more. But when it comes to scholarship, a huge difference overall. Okay. So yeah. So, I mean, if you think you can get a 760 with let's say 15 days of investment, which I think if you were getting, you probably can, given our experience with other students, definitely push for it. I mean, it's worth this thing. And especially because, I mean, you, when you took the GMAT the second time, you were you were suffering from COVID, or in some ways the infection was still there in your body. So definitely that's there. One consideration that I would really have is if you decide to take it again, you'll have to take it in the test center, so you'll have to practice taking the exam with the mask on. Now the good thing is you don't wear glasses, so that's okay. But for people like me who wear glasses, this is terrible. So that thing, that's where you are lucky. But again, do practice taking the tests with the mask on. So that's okay. Something that I would say. Well, if you do decide to take it again, reach out to the team, ask them how can they simulate mocks from using questions in Scholaranium, because you've exhausted all the mocks. Then the third question, which I think is a bigger question, which was there, was about employment visa, to really say, okay, how do you decide which schools to go for? How do you decide where you have employment opportunities? So two or three things, and a lot of people don't know this, and it's just because there's so much noise about it. Everything that's happening around H-1B is great news for you guys. It's wonderful news for you guys. Why? Because the problem with H-1B today, and frankly what it was 4 years ago, was that with H-1B, a lot of the jobs, H-1B has a quota of 85,000 seats. It's purely by numbers. Okay, and H-1B is a lottery system, which means it's not a merit-based system, it's a lottery system, which, again, it's very stupid if you think about how it is. So there are 85,000 H-1B visas that are granted every year. Out of these, 65,000 are open to anybody. 20,000 are reserved for folks who do higher education. So if you go through higher education, you know, all the people who go through higher education in the U.S., they go for that 20,000 first and then the 65,000. So all 85,000 are open to you. Now, historically, what has been happening is that for these 85,000 seats, there have been about 300,000 to 400,000 applications every year. So which means even when you get a job, you have a 1 in 5 or 1 in 4 chance to get a visa.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, post your MBA, you actually used to get 2 chances to go for a visa. You'd have right after your business school, and then you had 1 year of optional practical training. So the virtue of the fact that you're doing an MBA gets you 1 year of work permit right away. So it gives you 2 chances to apply for it. Now, with most schools becoming STEM schools, that has now increased to 3 years of OPT, which means you get 4 chances to apply for it. But even then, it's a lottery system. You could get unlucky, right? Now, what's happening now is, what they're saying is, people who earn more money, they actually, it's going to go more towards a merit-based system. So people who earn more money, they get a priority, and which kind of makes sense. Now, so the reason why you had 400,000 applications was because a good chunk of those applications came from TCS, Infosys, Satyam, and those guys who would simply get people who would replace the existing people over here. So they'd pay them $70,000 a year and to replace existing Americans, which wasn't the intent of H-1B. H-1B is a visa for individuals for which skills don't exist, or for jobs for which skills don't exist. So when this goes towards a merit-based system, you guys win. Why? Because an average MBA earns about $150,000. So the seats are not changing. They cannot change. It's 85,000 quota remains the same. It's just that your chance of actually getting a job because of that quota increases.
Okay. I think that's quite good.
So good. And which is kind of where, you know, you hear all of this noise. Why? Because who's making this noise? TCS, Satyam, Infosys. Why? Because they are the ones who are losing out on this.
Yeah.
So they will make that noise. Economic Times will make that noise because they are being paid by TCS, Satyam, Infosys. They are like $100+ billion corporations.
Yeah.
But you guys, really good. In fact, I wrote an article on this in 2018 when all of this started. It said, the H-1B, the changes to H-1B visa, there's a boon for MBA. And actually, the numbers that I talk about them in a lot more detail in that article. So if you Google this, and if you say EGMAT H-1B visa boon for MBA, you would get to that. I think that's about a 20-page article that I wrote with lots and lots of stats.
Okay. I'll definitely have a look.
So now this is the US. Now comparing US versus Europe, US has a proper path where you can get a visa, you can get a green card, you can get a citizenship. Europe, it may seem like it's more friendly, doesn't have a path. Now, having said that, if you get into a top business school, whether it's US, Europe, Singapore, or Canada, you won't have to worry about jobs. So if you get into LBS or INSEAD, I mean, people will employ you regardless of whether they can find a job for you in France or whether it's Netherlands or they'll find a house for you. So you don't have to worry about it. So, I mean, focus on getting into top business schools and let the business schools worry about jobs for you. That's their job.
Okay. So in that sense, I mean, getting a employment visa shouldn't really be an impediment in making my decision as to what colleges to.
Yeah. So, I mean, I'll tell you from some of our former students who I'm in touch with, people who started in Keenan Flagler this year, a couple of former EGMAT employees have gotten into B schools this year. So one of our former guys, Sharang, he started at Keenan Flagler this year. I don't know if he's still in India, probably has flown out to North Carolina, but what he said was that internships that are supposed to start in May of 2021, they're already getting offers for those.
Okay.
So, and this is Keenan Flagler. This is not, you know, GSB Chicago or Columbia. Keenan Flagler is slightly lower, ranked slightly lower than those schools. So bottom line, get into a top business school, and I think let the schools worry about it.
Okay, got it. I think that was very helpful. I mean, because I had at least this mindset before talking to you that, you know, this should be an important factor in deciding the colleges. If I'm not going to get a visa, what's the point of, you know, investing that kind of time and money effort in that country?
Yeah, I mean, think about it this way. These schools... The brand of these schools is built upon students' feedback. They will not they will not admit you if they can't get you a job.
Okay.
All right.
Yeah, that makes sense, actually.
All right, Raghav. I think it's a pleasure talking to you. I actually have to get on another call in about 4 minutes and Zoom's kind of not behaving properly. So I have to fix that again. Okay, but it was a pleasure talking to you. Someone from the EGMAT team is going to reach out asking for a review on GMAT Club. If you can do that, that'd be great.
Okay, I will definitely.
Okay, all right. Thank you, Raghav, and good luck. If you for your future attempts, do reach out to us if you need help planning for the next attempt. If you do decide to take that, and keep me updated as to where you get in.
Okay. Well, I just had one quick question. I know you're running short on time, but just one quick question.
Mm-hmm.
May I?
Yeah, sure.
If in the next 1 year, if I get into, say, some kind of business, if I want to do my own thing, do you think that will be any kind of impediment in, or will that be looked upon in terms of my work experience compared to me just continuing doing law, what I'm doing currently?
It depends on what how does it gel with what you want to do post your MBA.
Okay.
If you get into finance and if you want to do finance post your MBA, it would actually add to it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. If you really open a kirane ke dukaan and then say, I want to do finance, then it's not going to be great.
Thank you. I think that answers my question. Thank you so much.
All right. Okay, Raghav. Great talking to you and good luck.
Thank you, Raghav. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.